Thank you. Thank you for inviting me. What I want to talk about today is I'm going to actually focus on the human side of the human-animal interaction, which is what I do. I'm a psychologist. I study human-animal relationships. I've been doing this for about 30 years. Can you hear me okay, by the way, in the back? Good. Okay. The theme of this conference is I am not an animal. I decided, being a psychologist, I would do some empirical research and getting ready for it, and that I would actually talk to a person about their relationship with animals and what they thought about animals and probe their minds. And I used the mind of my grandson, Hal Herzog, who at the time was 5 years old. And he's in an interesting situation because his mother is a lifelong vegetarian who does not eat meat at all. And his father, my son, loves nothing more than barbecues and steaks. And so the kid was sort of raised in this home, and he's identified in terms of diet with his father. By the way, he also makes some other things. He knows that people that like country music tend to like meat, as opposed to punk rockers who are more likely to be vegetarians. And he's an animal lover. He always likes animals. His favorite animal is Curious George. So the idea of I am not an animal, he wants to be an animal. He wants to be Curious George, in fact, so much so that this is him for Halloween this year. He became Curious George for Halloween. So the bad part of me likes to screw up little kids' heads. And I take great joy in this. My own children have suffered for it. Now my grandchildren are suffering for it. So I had a conversation with him about, in which I tried to convince him that humans were made out of meat. And it was impossible. He would not believe that humans were made out of meat. So in preparation for this conference, I actually sat him down, and we had a little conversation about, and he wrote it down, and I wrote it down together, about what animals were made out of meat. And the question is, are people made out of meat? So this is Ryland's taxonomy of meat. And I don't know if you can see this from where you are, but in this column, roughly in his bad handwriting and coupled with my bad handwriting, meat, it includes cows, pigs, chicken, fish, birds, monkey, there's a question mark, and he said monkeys in Africa. And I think in retrospect, he was thinking like, Curious George is a monkey, we wouldn't eat him. So maybe it's just monkeys in Africa are the meat. And I said, well, what about chimpanzees? And he clearly said, no. To him, a chimpanzee was not meat. Well, what is not meat? Well, dogs are not meat, cats are not meat. Big Bird, even though birds are meat, Big Bird is not meat, according to Ryland. People are not meat. And then instantly he said, are there any other elephants that are not? Any other animals that are not meat? He said, elephants. Now, why he put elephant in that category, I'm not sure why, but he was very clear about that. So, and he had to do some thinking here. So this gets to the issue, why is it hard for us to think about animals? Why are we so morally inconsistent about it? I've been thinking about this for a long time, and it really came to a fore for me when I was working on my doctoral dissertation. My PhD is in ethology. I started out studying animal behavior. At one point, I needed a doctoral dissertation. I was living in Western North Carolina, way out in the woods. And though I'd previously been studying the behavior of snakes and alligators and crocodiles and things like that, I thought, well, I had chickens in my yard, so I thought, well, maybe I'll study the behavior of chickens. I was going to study baby chicks. I was going to look at genetic differences in different types of baby chicks and their behavior. And it turns out that one of my neighbors was a rooster fighter, so I could get baby rooster, baby gamecocks to see if they're different than other chickens. And that sort of got me into this world of cockfighting. And so my dissertation's topic sort of shifted. And yeah, part of it was on the behavior of chickens, but a lot of it was that I basically hung around with cockfighters, Western North Carolina cockfighters, for 2 years. They were very nice to me. They let me into their world. I went to cockfights regularly with these guys. I'd go in there with a clipboard and paper and take notes and stuff like that, and they were fine. This is, by the way, before the Animal Welfare Act, and cockfighting was illegal, about as illegal as littering in North Carolina. That's not the case now. But I met guys like this. So I'm calling Eddie Buckner. That's not his real name. The most interesting thing about this guy is that he's not all that interesting. In other words, he's just a regular guy. He's conservative, he votes Republican, he goes to church, he's a good family man, he raises kids, he's got a couple chickens that he keeps for pets. He's absolutely and deeply, deeply, deeply involved, both in terms of his self-concept and in terms of how he spends his time and his money in this brutal blood sport. And so before I started getting in with these guys, my stereotype of rooster fighters was that these guys are, you know, psychosexual sadists, that they really enjoy animal suffering and stuff like that, and I found that was not the case. They were just, you know, everyday, you know, country people living in the mountains that had this one weird thing that they did. So this, I maintain, is a good guy who does bad things. On the other hand, about the same time, I realized that there was the opposite situation with another animal lover. By the way, I'm convinced rooster fighters, in their own twisted way, love and deeply respect roosters. So on the other hand, I became aware of this guy, who you're all familiar with, Adolf Hitler, truly evil person, who was a true animal lover. He claimed to be a vegetarian. Some people argue that he was not. That argument's not of interest to me. But not only was Hitler an animal person, a lot of his Nazi hierarchy, Himmler, Goebbels, guys like that. Goebbels, I think, once said that I'll put in a concentration camp anyone who's mean to an animal. And the Nazis, when they came to power, enacted the world's most progressive animal rights legislation, most animal protection legislation. They banned hunting with dogs. They had the first legislation to protect the use of animals in movies. They had a Humane Slaughter Act, which actually covered lobsters being boiled in Berlin restaurants. What I think is the most bizarre, the most twisted moral inversion that I know, I still can't wrap my head around it, I've been thinking about it for years, is that in 1942, the Nazis made it illegal for Jews to own pets. They rounded up the pets, the dogs and the cats owned by the Jews, and they killed them. But they killed them in accordance to the Humane Slaughter Act in Nazi Germany, so they killed them as painlessly as possible. On the other hand, what were they doing to the Jews themselves? They were rounding them up and putting them in concentration camps. So I was giving a talk at one of the first international conferences on human-animal interactions back in the 80s, put on by Andrew Rowan, who some of you may know. And Andrew, who's with the HSUS, now head of Humane Society International, said to me, you know, speaking of this stuff, the only thing consistent about human attitudes towards animals is inconsistency. And I now call this, you know, Rowan's paradox, and it's one of those things that's just haunted me, and I've been studying for quite a while now. So that's what I want to talk about. So when we talk about human thinking about animals, immediately the issue of consistency comes up. And according to psychologists, there's sort of two views of human moral judgment. There's the consistency view, and it was nicely illustrated by this quote by the environmental philosopher you may be familiar with, J. Baird Caldecott, who said, human beings deeply need and mightily strive for consistency and coherence in our outlook on the natural world. This follows from the groundbreaking work of the well-known psychologist, Leon Festinger, and I'm sure you've all heard the term cognitive dissonance. This was his term. And he argued that dissonance is the mental state. We get disturbed. We get anxious when we try and hold two incompatible ideas at the same times inside our head. So mental stress or discomfort experienced by an individual who holds two or more contradictory beliefs or ideas and values at the same time. So we have cognition one, cognition two, incompatibility. We get this dissonance, and then people change. Okay, that's one view. Humans are rational actors, and we try and maintain some cognitive coherence in our moral worlds. The other view is illustrated, actually, is a direct quote. Randy just used it in his talk. Homer Simpson, who recently on The Simpsons, did you get it from Homer Simpson? It turns out that Homer Simpson was a plagiarist. It was from F. Scott Fitzgerald. I looked it up. Who, in a recent episode of The Simpsons, said, the test of a first-rate intelligence is the ability to hold two opposing ideas in the mind at the same time and still retain the ability to function. I also heard a version of this view, interesting, some of you may know, Brooke Gladstone from her show, National Public Radio show on the media, and she was interviewing Nate Silver, who does the well-known blog 538, and she asked Nate a question. How you were doing with the political situation in the United States. Nate, is it really possible for people to hold two contradictory ideas at the same time? And he said, absolutely, Brooke, people are complicated. I am in the school of Homer Simpson. I think that's going to be the theme of this talk. It's going to be why Homer Simpson's right and Leon Festinger was mostly wrong. Not completely wrong, but mostly wrong. And we can see these inconsistencies in our behavior. It's not something that's just theoretical. So, for example, a Gallup poll in 2015 found that about 65% of American adults, randomly selected, said they felt animals had the same rights as people. Now, one presumes this would be the right not to be killed because you taste good, but apparently that's not the case. 30% said animals deserve some protection. About 5% said not much. However, as we heard this morning, one place we can look to see how our real attitudes towards animals and how much we value them is how much money we spend on their behalf. And this is data that I got a couple years ago. We heard today that we spend roughly $10 billion on animal protection each year. Back then, it was more like $4 or $5 billion. But at the same time, we were spending roughly, the best I could find out, which was difficult to find this out, about $60 billion on animal research, over $100 billion on recreational hunting and fishing, and a whopping $225 billion on the animals that we eat. So in other words, we spend roughly 100 times as much on killing animals as we do on trying to save animals. So here's some reasons, actually seven reasons, why it's so far hard for us to think about animals. Now, there's more than seven reasons. This is a complicated issue. But here's seven that I'm going to pick out and talk about. First of all, and this is, I think, one of the most difficult ones, because probably everyone in this room, most people in this room, would argue that there's no fundamental difference between humans and animals. And I think that view is wrong. When people think about animals is a hell of a broad category. It includes everything from lice to humans. And when people say they love animals, what are they really thinking of? I think for the most part, they're thinking of their dogs, their cats, you know, charismatic megafauna. You know, they're not thinking of invertebrates. They're not thinking of spiders and stuff like that. So when we're like other species in so many ways, which is reflected in this, you know, tender picture of the chimpanzee, which everybody in here can relate to. You know, you give those, you know, you shave those guys and, you know, put them in a wig and stuff like that, and they would look just like us. On the other hand, we have the tick, and then these weird guys. It's hard to know what their worlds are like, but none of these animals has anywhere near the neural power, the cognitive abilities to do that. And to me, that counts for something. And even animal rights philosophers, our best animal rights philosophers, acknowledge that. So for example, Tom Regan, who just, you know, tragically died last week, one of the original thinkers in the field, really, really smart guy, and a really, really nice person. He, in his book, The Case for Animal Rights, devotes 4 pages to explaining why, if we have, you know, 3 guys in a lifeboat and a dog, and one of them has to go, it should always be the dog. Furthermore, he argues that if there's 1 million dogs in the lifeboat and 1 person, you should throw out 1 million dogs to save the 1 person. I've read that section of the book many, many, many times. I still don't have a clue how he comes. Am I right about this?
I know.
Okay, I just want to make sure I get my animal rights philosophy right. Okay, Peter Singer, got in an argument with some animal rights activists over what was a greater tragedy on 9/11. And for Singer, the answer was clear. It was the deaths of 3,000 people that died that day. And he says it's a vastly greater tragedy than the 30 million chickens that day. Tomorrow, we're going to hear a talk by Stephen Weiss. His movie is on HBO now, by the way. Strongly suggest you look at it. It's stunning. I saw it the other night. And in his book, Drawing the Line, he he's one of the few philosophers, lawyers, who's actually done his homework in terms of going to the literature on cognitive ethology and looking at what we know about animal behavior. And he says, yeah, there are legitimate species differences. And he bases his thinking on what he calls practical autonomy, and he has a scale, and he ranks species on this scale. Some of these species deserve rights comparable to that of humans, others don't. So there is a moral difference. There is a difference between humans and other species, even though we are them. The second reason why it's hard for us to think straight about animals is that in some ways we have a Stone Age mind and a modern body. This is a classic cliche from evolutionary psychology. And I used to be more of a fan of evolutionary psychology than I am now, but I think it does explain some of our interactions with the animals. For example, one of the most natural of our, I would argue that one of the most natural of our interactions with animals is our desire to eat them, as illustrated by this chimpanzee with this big hunk of whatever that is in his hand. We evolved from a line of meat-eating apes. I think Richard Wrangham said he's never seen a chimpanzee in the wild that didn't crave meat. Chimps don't actually eat that much meat. It makes up less than 3% of their diet. But most paleoanthropologists argue it was the increase in meat consumption that probably fueled the tremendous increase in the size of our brain over a relatively short period of time. However, just because things are natural, don't make them morally correct. There's tons of things in the animal world that are natural that suck. Sexual assault is common in the animal world. Incest is common in the animal world. There's just been a book that's come out last week on cannibalism. Cannibalism is common in the animal world. We don't want to emulate animals and turn to animals for our sense of morality. However, it can make it difficult for our behavior to change. And so let's take a look at the ability to stop eating meat. It turns out that the campaign to eat, there have been successes, which I think I'll have time to talk about in the animal rights movement, and there's been failures. The campaign to get people to stop eating meat has been a dramatic failure. We kill 3 times as many animals for their flesh now as we did in 1975 when Peter Singer wrote Animal Liberation. The average American eats about 70 pounds per meat more per year, more than they did when Peter Singer ate Animal Liberation. And this is not data from the Meat Council. This is data from the Vegetarian Resource Group, the number of people in the United States that eat meat. So the number of true vegetarians, people that do not eat any form of animal flesh, typically fluctuates in surveys, usually between about 6 and 4%. Oftentimes, it's more than the margin of error in these polls. So we really don't know about trends. It's possible that meat consumption is going down a little bit now, but it's not been very much. On the other hand, so I would argue that meat's an addictive substance. But on the other hand, some addictive substances do change. For example, this is a relatively successful campaign, also health-related, the campaign to get people to stop smoking. And as you can see, there's a number of, this is from 1954 to 2013, the number of people that smoked, and the adults who smoked in the United States dropped roughly by 50%. So I'm sure we would love that meat number to go down like that, but interestingly enough, it has not. And I would argue that part of that's related to biology. The fact that even vegetarians have trouble maintaining consistency with meat is particularly interesting. And speaking of not using someone for moral models, Bill Clinton, I'm not sure we want to use him as a moral model, but he did go vegan about 10 years ago, primarily for health reasons. And he went on Oprah and CNN and all that and raving about his new conversion to veganism, how he feels better than he'd ever felt in his life, how he'd lost weight, and he was never going to eat animals again. And then he snuck in the sentence, "Now I try to eat salmon once a week." So Bill Clinton is a salmon-eating vegan, and he is not the only one. I remember one time when I was talking about vegetarianism to one of our graduate students who told me she was a vegetarian, while I watched her devour a tuna fish sandwich. I mean, she had no clue. How many of you, by the way, have been in that situation? Yeah, it's not, I'm not too surprised. The USDA, Department of Agriculture, did a study some years ago where it was a big study of dietary habits of Americans. They called 13,000 Americans they asked them about their diets. Do you eat meat? How often? Are you a vegetarian? Et cetera, et cetera. The interesting thing was they then called these people back 2 weeks later, and they asked them what they had eaten, what they had put in their mouth in the previous 24 hours. What they found was that 2/3 of the vegetarians had eaten meat in the previous 24 hours, not the previous week or previous month, the previous 24 hours. And by the way, other studies have found the same thing. So this is not an anomaly. Time magazine did a study. They found exactly the same thing. So, and you will probably be somewhat disheartened. I'm keeping on the depressing theme that Randy started us on. I want to sort of keep the ball going here. Recent study by Faunalytics, Che Green's group that keeps track of animal issues, found that I think it was about 75% of vegetarians go back to eating meat. The interesting thing they found was about 60% of vegans go back to eating meat. So it's a problem. Now, when I wrote my chapter on meat, you know, when you write a book, there's always stuff that's like, God, I wish I had known that when I wrote the book. I would have wrote that chapter differently. One of the things I would most write differently in that book is the chapter on meat. And I was unaware of the enormous cultural differences in meat consumption. I was really sort of, I guess I'd watched too many Hardee's burger commercials. I thought everyone in the world was scarfing down, you know, giant hunks of burger. And that's simply not true. We're pretty much off the charts when it comes to meat consumption. And on the other hand, you've got, you know, countries like the United States where people are eating about 240 pounds per capita. You've got places like, you know, India, Bangladesh, where they're eating less than 10 pounds of meat per capita per year. So, you know, I argued that I'm still convinced that meat eating is so-called natural, but in reality, it's hugely influenced by culture. And by the way, I have twin daughters, and so I have a natural experiment going on at my house. They're fraternal twins. One of my daughters for 20 years was a vegetarian, and the other one was not. So I think it's actually genetically easier for some people to eat meat. They're fraternal twins, not identical, to give up meat than others. Evolution also affects the animals we fear. I'm not buying the idea that we heard earlier that our fear of snakes is completely cultural. And what we find in the United States is that snake phobias are the most common phobia. They're even the most common phobia in Maine, a state in which there are no poisonous snakes at all. Now, poisonous snakes were a threat to humans for most of human history, and in parts of the world, they are today. So right now, roughly 100,000 people a year in the world die from snake bites. But if you get bit or killed by a snake in the United States, it's like it's God's will, because most people that get bitten by snakes are trying to hold the snake to show it off to their girlfriend. And my favorite example is a guy who got bitten the tongue by a rattlesnake. He did not die. He deserved to die. We don't want those guys' genes going by. So how do you get bitten the tongue by a rattlesnake? Well, you have to hold it up like this and start flicking your tongue at the rattlesnake. So you don't have to be stupid to get bit by a snake, but get killed by a snake, but it helps. On the other hand, there is an animal that's likely to cause you injury, perhaps not death, but injury, and that is dogs. You're 100 times more likely to get bitten or seriously injured or killed by a dog than you are a snake. But yet, fear of snakes is much more common than that. Now, it's clear that it's not completely genetic, but there's a learning factor. Studies with children, a number of empirical studies with children and monkeys have shown that fear of snakes is particularly easy to learn. It's particularly easy to acquire. So there seems to be a gene learning interaction there. Evolution also affects the animals that we care about. And I'm going to just show you two species here. One is the baby harp seal. Everybody cares about the baby harp seal. And of course, these guys were killed extensively, bludgeoned to death on the Arctic ice in Canada. And there was a worldwide, somewhat successful campaign to get this stopped. Well, why do people care so much about the baby harp seals? It's like, they're the cutest animal on Earth, I think. On the other hand, nobody got riled up about a much more endangered, rare, and biologically interesting animal, the giant Chinese salamander, which basically looks like a 150-pound bag of brown slime with little beady eyes. So the World Wildlife Fund does not put them on there. They're not the logo of the World Wildlife Fund. You don't raise much money on Save the Giant Chinese Salamander. Evolution, and we know that there's now biological programming for us to be suckers with creatures, our own infants, some of the pets we bring into our lives, and even things like Mickey Mouse. And it has to do with things like big eyes that release our maternal instincts. We know that now because we know there's a biological basis for this because this rather fascinating study done at University of Pennsylvania. So I want to get your opinion on this now. So we have two kids, the kid on the top. There's three pictures of the kid on the top, three pictures of the kid on the bottom. The actual photo of the kid is B. That's the actual unretouched photo. A is a retouched photo, these two, and these two are retouched photos. Okay, now let's take a vote. Which kid is cutest? Now, how many of you say kids A are the cutest? Raise your hands. Did you?
You have to vote for both A's at the same time?
Yeah, you do. I know this is tough. Do your best, kind of put them together in your mind. Okay, how many vote for pair B? Oh, I'm sorry, C. So you were the outlier. I've never had anybody, you're the first person that's ever voted for A. Now, I've got to admit, I don't know what it's different about these two things. What is it that most people, vast majority of people say this guy is cuter than this guy? What is it about him? What? His eyes are bigger? They're not that much bigger. They're just a tiny bit bigger, right? Anything else beside the eyes? Yeah. What? The cranium? Yeah, the size of the cranium? Anything else? What?
Symmetry.
Oh, interesting. Evolutionary psychologists are big on symmetry. It would be interesting to see if symmetry was actually a factor in that. What the researchers at the University of Pennsylvania did, they were interested in, does the brain fire differently when we see this kid versus this kid? And so they put women who had never had kids, never had experience, never had a lot of experience with kids, in a functional MRI machine. They showed them these pictures. And then they recorded their brain activity, what part of their brain was most active. They subtracted brain activity here from brain activity here. And they discovered that there was an area in the brain that seemed pretty much was turned on much more by this set of kids. And interestingly enough, there's an area called the nucleus accumbens, which is a major brain reward center. So this is an area that puts out the neurotransmitter dopamine, which is one of our primary reward things. So when you get a, I got to go fast. What's that?
I'm just giving you a heads up.
Okay.
Go as long as you want.
I'm going to start going fast. Okay. So in animal ethics, categories count. We have pets, pests, and meals. Take a simple category system. I'll try and talk fast. And now, in the last 20 years, for reasons I'm not completely clear, although I have a theory, pets have become family members. So 65% of American homes have a pet. That's not changed much in about 20 years. 90% of pet owners, you won't be surprised, think of their pets as family members. This is sad. 40% of married women in one survey said, I get more emotional support from my dog than my kids or husband. And 56% of pet owners would not sell their pet for $1 million. This is my cat, Tilly. She's really cute. I would sell her for $1 million. I'm a bad person. I don't care. If you're interested, see me. I'll give some money. I'll give half of the money to the animal rights organization of your choice. But she's for sale. She's for sale. Nobody's taking me up on this. Okay, in recent years, we've seen the humanization of pets. So we have pet TV. We have a dog TV channel. We have people that get their dogs married. Emory's Greg Burns has done some amazing studies with the similarities between human brain function and dog brain function, and had a piece in the New York Times, Dogs Are People Too. But there are moral consequences to the humanization of pets. So for example, one way psychologists studying moral problems is what's called the trolley problem. You may have heard of it. Scenario is we got five people who God knows why are on the railroad tracks. We got a runaway trolley. We got you up there with the frown. we got a big fat guy who's got a real big frown, and the question is, should you push the fat guy over and he's heavy enough to stop the trolley? And there's lots of you know, you can vary it in a number of ways. Richard Topolsky at Georgia Regents University had an animal version of this. You see the bus headed towards a dog and one person, you can only save one. Would you save the dog rather than a foreign tourist, a hometown stranger, a cousin, your best friend, your grandmother, your brother, your sister? Oh. To me, that's a no-brainer. I don't know. My wife and I had conversations about this, actually. Okay. So this is what they found. Foreign tourists. And when you ask the question this way, most people say that they would save even the foreign tourists from instead of the dog. However, if you change one word, you get a completely different pattern of response. What's the word? Your. And all of a sudden it becomes their dog. All of a sudden 40% of people said that they're going to save the foreign tourists. I don't think they actually would, but the very fact that they think they would is interesting. I worry about these people. I do. I worry about them. By the way, women, I was going to show you a slide, but I didn't. Women are much more likely to save the animal than the... Now, a fourth reason why it's so hard to think straight about animals is that culture plays an enormous role in this. I've got a colleague, Nyak Maniki, who is an anthropologist who's from the Kiambu tribe of Kenya. They have no word for pet. Now, they have dogs. And I said, what do the dogs do in your culture? He said, well, we keep them around to scare away strangers. We keep them ready to scare around animals from the field. I said, would you ever let a dog in your house? He said, no. I said, would you ever pet your dog? The dog just hangs around your house. He said, no. I said, so would you ever let the dog sleep in your bed? And the look he got on his face was like, I said to you, would you let her? Would you let, here's a dead rat. Would you mind sleeping with it? That's the look he had on his face. Pet keeping is not a human universal. There are 400 and some odd human universals, language, dancing, art, myths, stuff like that. Pet keeping is not one. Peter Gray at University of Las Vegas, Nevada, has done did a nice work on comparing the different cultures and how they deal with dogs. I'll make a long story short. He basically found that dogs had, in the 60 cultures he looks at, dogs had jobs. They were involved in hunting, defense, work, eating garbage. In only 5 of these cultures did people treat dogs the way we treat dogs. So the way we treat, bring animal pets into our lives is a cultural aberration. It's one that spread like Coca-Cola and McDonald's, but it's basically a cultural aberration. A fifth reason it's hard to think straight about animals is that we use these unconscious mental shortcuts when we make moral decisions. And psychologists call these heuristics. And Daniel Kahneman, Nobel Prize winning behavioral economist, did a study related to how people think about animals. And the issue had to deal with seabirds, saving seabirds that were in oil spills. And he was interested in a heuristic called anchoring, which is the effect of an initial reference point on how much decisions, including how much you're willing to pay. So he asked people, how much would you be, he asked one group of people, how much would you be willing to pay 50,000 seabirds? Another group of people, the first thing he said was, like, would you be willing to pay $5 to save 50,000 seabirds? Most people said yes. And then he said, well, how much would you be willing to pay? Sounds like you'd be willing to pay more. And then there's another group of people, he said, would you be willing to pay $400 to save 50,000 seabirds? And almost everybody said no. And he said, how much would you weigh? So it turns out that anchor point had an enormous impact on the value people gave to these seabirds. So in the no anchor condition, people on average said $60. If you started them out with $5, they went up to $20. If you started out with, $400, they were willing to pay 7 times as much. So again, this isn't rational. It's the way our brain operates because of these evolved heuristics. Then there's the issue of emotion versus reason and how we make moral judgments. And there's sort of 2 views of moral decision making in psychology historically. One is associated with the Harvard psychologist, the late Lawrence Kohlberg. And he argued that humans were rational, adult humans at least, were rational decision makers. When making a moral judgment, we look at the pros and cons, what's right and what's wrong. We think about it, and then we make a moral judgment. The new view, on the other hand, says that no. this is the part that Kohlberg emphasized. The new view emphasizes, I could have put a stomach there instead of a heart, but I put a heart because I found the thing. But our decision making is gut level, is determined primarily by gut level factors. And the psychologist we associate with this is John Haidt. And he developed what's called the social intuitionist theory of ethics. And he basically compares ethical judgment to an elephant and a rider. There's these rival, what he calls operating systems. The rider is smart, he can think, it's the person on top of the elephant, but ultimately it's the elephant that is doing most of the calling of the shots because it's bigger, it's more powerful. So these are system one and system two decisions, and so the elephant is the more powerful one. It's driven by emotion, it's instantaneous, it's unconscious. On the other hand, the rider is rational, it's slow, it's conscious, and what it often does is we make the decision with our guts, and then we figure out why we made the decisions and come up with reasons that we make decisions. Does that make sense? So what's really important in moral judgment is emotion more than logic, and this was beautifully illustrated to me when I did my first study on human-animal interactions was cockfighters. My second study was on animal rights activists. And I interviewed a whole series of animal rights activists, why they became animal rights activists, how it affected their lives, and things like that. And one was a woman named Karen, who beautifully illustrated Haidt's theory. She's very bright, very articulate. Karen, I asked, was emotion or logic more important in your conversion to animal rights activism? And she said, for me, it always stems from the emotional, but I have to find an intellectual rationalization for my reactions. Otherwise, people won't take me seriously. It's a nice summary of this view. Now, many of the people that I talked to said that. However, some were not like that. Some said we're completely driven by rationality, but they were rare. We actually did a study on the role of one moral emotion, what's been called the moral emotion, disgust in animal activists. And Lauren Golden and I reasoned that it might be the case that animal activists would tend to be more disgust prone, because again, that's a moral emotion, than would other people. And we compared we used a scale called the disgust scale, well-regarded scale, and what we found was, sure enough, the animal activists we looked at were in fact more prone to disgust than were people that used animals, for example, in laboratory research. The seventh reason, the last reason, is why I just put up there, because this study was just published recently. And this conference is about the difference between the way that we differentiate ourselves from animals. But some people don't do that. Some people do just the opposite. My guess is a lot of you in this room are like that, is that you feel solidarity with animals. Well, two really good social psychologists, Catherine Amiot and Brock Bastian, have recently developed a scale. It was developed from a social psychology scale designed to measure solidarity with other humans. They adapted it with animals. Here's the scale. It consisted of a series of five items. I feel strong bond with other animals. I feel solidarity towards animals. I feel committed to animals. I feel close to other animals. I feel a strong connection to other animals. My guess is that most of you would score very high on this scale. And it turns out that predicted a ton of things. Their paper's well worth reading. It was published in PLOS One about a month ago. People that scored high on the scale scored low on speciesism. They were high on interpersonal empathy generally. They tended to be, as a personality trait, they tended to be open to new experiences than most people, more open. They were highly attached to their pets. They had low frequency of meat eating. They expressed more general moral concern for animals. And the interesting thing to me was that this was not related to that solidarity toward humans. So sometimes people tell me, you know, a lot of my friends are animal activists and are very concerned about animals. And, you know, some people say, well, if you like animals, you tend not to identify with other people or like other people. And I found that that's not true. Some people are like that, but most people are not. And what they found was that there was no relationship. So this solidarity in animals seems to be a completely separate trait than solidarity with other people. Finally, I want to go back to consistency. We've got a couple more minutes. Is that okay? Okay. I want to go back to consistency. Elizabeth Anderson's a psychologist who wrote a book on human-animal interactions, and she wrote, how a person who has ever loved, kissed a kitten can turn a blind eye to the head smashing of a baby seal, I will never understand. Well, I don't understand why she doesn't understand. Because to me, after studying this stuff for a long time, I see this all the time. I think these kinds of inconsistencies are absolutely characteristics of our interactions with animals. It's the way we are built. Indeed, we have problems when we try and be too consistent. And my, someday I'm going to meet Joan Dunnier, and she's probably going to beat me up, because I use her for an example of what happens when moral consistency runs amok. So what Joan Dunnier did is, she's a strong animal advocate. She takes Peter Singer's argument that all sentient creatures deserve moral status because they feel pleasure and pain, and look where she winds up. She winds up where, my saying, this is quotes from her book, am I saying that a spider has as much right to a human? She says, yes. That, she says, that termites have the right to eat your house. It's your fault. You put it in their territory. And that if you're going by a burning building, there just happens to be a puppy in there and a human infant, you should flip a coin before deciding which one to save. This is nuts. This is what happens when logic runs amok. And try to explain to your, you're not going to make friends and converts by explaining to somebody that termites have the right to eat your house and that you shouldn't call the exterminator. So I've become more and more aware that moral consistency, I think, is overrated as a philosophical principle. So my take-home message is, why is it so hard to think straight about animals? Well, the fact is, it's hard for humans to think straight about everything. With animals, it gets really complicated because, it's, as I mentioned, it's such a big category, from ticks to, you know, chimpanzees and whales. But in the real world, our moral judgments about animals is this mishmash of conflicting influence. Part of it's genetic, part of it's biology, part of it's our evolutionary heritage. Culture plays an enormous role. I now think culture plays a much bigger role in human life than I used to think. The categories we put people in, it's our intuition and it's our rational ability to think rationally. So we have all these things mixed up, and of course we're confused about these things. And again, I've become, in recent years, I've come to accept moral inconsistency. You have to learn to live with moral inconsistency or your life is going to suck. I genuinely believe that. You have to draw a line somewhere if you're going to have a happy life. And on that note, thanks for listening. By the way, this is the part of the conference that I've come to dread, because I think there's more brain power in this room than I'm normally used to speaking to. So
thank you, Hal. And I just want to introduce Carrie Packwood Freeman. And Carrie teaches communications at Georgia State University and has two radio shows in town here, In Tune to Nature and Second Opinion Radio. You're a cultural studies media researcher. You published a whole lot on strategic communication for activists, on media ethics, environmental communications, animal agribusiness, and critical animal studies. And Carrie's going to lead some discussion with Hal and then with all of us as we go on.
Oh, when Hal and I were talking before, I was saying that, I'm going to ask you questions mostly about, since I'm an animal activist, I'm like, what should we do with this information that you gave us? And he's like, wait a minute. I don't know that that's my area. So that's okay. I'm thinking that's okay. But we thought we would go ahead and have him set the stage a little bit for talking about his type of research, because some of us identify as like activist scholars or critical scholars and get very engaged in the research for activism. So tell us just a little bit about how you view animals, or how your animal welfare views inform or don't inform your research, just to set the stage.
Yeah, I think I'm a little different than most people in my field in that I have less of a political agenda. I was drawn to the field. Let me just say, first of all, I care a lot about animals. There's a reason that my PhD is in animal behavior, is because I wanted to spend my life studying animals. But that's not the reason why I got interested in the field of anthrozoology, why I got interested in studying whales. I did that because I found myself, first of all, bored with my own research, and I thought it was time for a change. And I became absolutely fascinated by animal people. And one of the things is the research I was doing with cockfighters, and I realized, wait, these guys really like animals at some level. And I was doing some stuff with animal activists at the same time, and I realized how much they loved animals and that they had this moral clarity in their lives that, at one level, I admired a lot, something I didn't have, but which I saw the pros of that, and I also saw some of the cons of that. But the other thing that happened was I read, as a lot of you probably did, my life sort of changed, my academic life changed, when I read Peter Singer's book. And I was an animal researcher at the time. And I remember I was flying back from a conference, and I think they had it at the airport, and I picked it up, and I started reading the book, and I was absolutely hooked. And I was completely prepared to completely dismiss his argument. And because, again, I was an animal researcher. Animal research was just starting to come under the gun. And I thought, well, this is just, another soft-hearted, puppy lover, writing about. And it was completely untrue. In fact, Peter Singer says very clear in the book, I don't like animals. He says, I'm not drawn to pets like other people are. Well, that got my attention. And then I read the book. I realized, this guy's, number one, he's right. Like, this is a really important argument because the guy's right. But I thought the book was not going to have much impact because I thought that it was people would not fall for the philosophical argument. And I was wrong about that, but I think that there's 82 pages of philosophy in Animal Liberation. The rest of the book is designed to appeal to the heart. So in reality, it was the double whammy. It was the perfect sweet spot in terms of changing people's mind. It appealed to both heart and mind. And so I was totally wrong. And when I started realizing this, that animals were a window into really deep questions in human nature, that's what drew me into this field. So I wasn't drawn into the field by love for animals. I was drawn in because I see it as a unique way of looking at what it means to be human. Surprisingly, my work has been useful for animal activists. For example, PETA uses my work. They seem to like me. Wayne Pacelli put my book on his top 10 Christmas list when it came out. I've sort of really been surprised, but that wasn't my agenda. But I don't consider myself an animal activist. And I feel in a way that one of the reasons why a lot of activists have sort of been very supportive of me is that because I don't have an agenda, I can do what I did to my grandson Rylan. If I can screw people's heads up, that helps the animal rights movement, because the fact is, you guys are right about most of these issues. That's the problem, you're right. So does that answer the question?
Okay, so my first question is about the paradoxical beliefs that we hold, that you're talking about, where most people say, oh, I care about animals, but yet I'll let them be hurt on my behalf or I'll hurt them. And I was kind of wondering, is this paradoxical belief that we have an opportunity for the animal and environmental protection movement, or is it a liability? From the standpoint of animal rights? Because on the one hand, it seems like it's an opportunity because of the potential cognitive dissonance, the fact that people do say they like animals. That helps, at least. Trump says he likes women and all these other people, and it's just like, is that good that he thinks that? I mean, it's weird, but, so that's a little bit, like, we're that delusional species like he is about how he's so feminist.
You're not comparing me to Trump, are you?
No, not you. Okay. I'm talking about humans. I'm, like, talking about, I didn't have that written down. I just extemporaneously added that in, just thinking how humans are like, oh, well, I care about animals, but then the way we behave, we're not showing that. And so that's, an example of that. But the fact that at least we say we care is good. Like, if there's a lot of people there that said, I didn't care about kittens at all, or I don't care about it, it'd be harder for our movement. So the fact that people say they want to treat animals fairly gives us that view of cognitive dissonance where we're thinking like, oh, so the movement, the animal rights movement, from my studies of them, certainly capitalizes on that by saying, they're always saying, oh, you know, a campaign for veganism would be like, oh, well, you know, dogs and pigs have similar, you know, brain structures or capabilities, and they're sensitive and they're smart, so why are you petting one and eating another? So they're trying to kind of show you what you're doing is out of sync, or they're trying to say, oh, you don't want to hurt animals, but let me show you how much animals are suffering in factory farms or all these kinds of things. So the question is, do you think perhaps that your research is suggesting that since we all can live with some moral inconsistencies, having animal rights activist messages that try to point out the paradoxes and problematize these moral inconsistencies is basically unproductive in some way?
Well, as you were asking your question, I remember thinking of my friend and colleague James Serpel at University of Pennsylvania. He makes an interesting argument. He said, when we started being more and more attached to pets and bringing them and thinking of them as people, that actually provided fertile ground for changing people's views about animal rights. And he actually seems to imply that there's a causal relationship there. One way to sort of frame that would be to ask, you know, would it be easier for animal rights for animal welfare, for people to change their behavior, if we were more logical and less motivated by gut level decisions? And I think the answer to that is sort of in some ways the answer is yes. For example, you might be familiar with the philosopher Milan Engel. Does that, some of you might know Milan. And I heard him give a talk one time, and he said, it's going to be really easy for us to change people's behavior to get people to give up eating meat. And all we have to do is to convince them of three things. And as I recall, I may be getting this wrong, my recollection was, it was like, number one, we have to get them he said differently. He said, you know, we're going to ask people, do you think of yourself as a good person? Well, everybody's going to say yes to that. And the second question was like, do you think a good person would engage in wanton cruelty to a creature, just, you know, for no good reason? And everybody's going to say, yeah, that's bad. And then he would say, all he's got to do is then convince him that, you know, for example, let's say eating factory farm chicken involves wanton cruelty. Well, the evidence for that is inconvertible. And he goes, well, you know, we got A, we got B, we got C. Therefore, D, the logical conclusion is I shouldn't eat meat, and therefore everybody's going to stop eating meat. And I remember thinking, like, no, people don't work like that. And what animal rights people need to do is they need to get together with psychologists to sort of try and understand these things. And I think that's actually happening now. And I was at a meeting recently that was organized by Animal Charities Evaluators. I mentioned that to you. And it was one of the most interesting meetings I'd ever been to. It was a small conference, probably 50 people there. But they had people there from psychology. They had people there from marketing. They had people there that were doing experiments on what kind of strategies actually work and don't work. They had some big-time statisticians. And it was just a lot of brain power taking a real empirical approach to trying to change attitudes. On the other hand, what if, you know, is it an opportunity if people are more motivated by heart than they are by logic? And I would argue, that's an opportunity too. And if you look at, and we talked about this a little bit before, and this gets into your area of communications. I taught a human sexuality course for for 20 years. And I saw attitudes towards homosexuality and attitudes towards gay marriage change in an unbelievably rapid way. And I attribute that to a couple of TV shows. One of them is Will and Grace. And I think that was a show where you invite somebody, in this case a gay character, into your home in the evening. That person becomes sort of your friend. And I think, you know, there have been some successes. One of the big successes has been SeaWorld getting rid of the orcas. And I think Free Willy, that's a heart movie. I think I would call that a heart movie. Blackfish. Laurie was very much involved in that. I think those are the kind of things that appeals to the heart. So I think both of those things sort of come into play, and you know, you can use both of those parts of human nature.
Yeah. My colleague, Deborah Merskin, who's over there, we had put together the animalsandmedia.org guidelines for the media. And so, and one of the things for entertainment media would be, can you model like a non-speciesist world for us? And literature and other, any kind of artist can do these things. Similar to what you're saying with Will and Grace, let's show people different relationships and maybe it will normalize it, or they'll see how out of sync their relationships are. What seems normal now is eating animals and raising them in factory conditions, and so people just, you know, everyone's doing it.
I mean, I'm sort of optimistic in some ways because I used to think it was almost impossible to change public behavior. Now I know it can be done fairly easy. One of the things that I study, by the way, this is, you weren't meaning to talk about this, but I study why dog breeds get popular and unpopular. And I've got this enormous data set, 60 million dogs. The AKC made the mistake of giving me this data set. And we were able to, and I work with cultural anthropologists. They don't care anything about dogs. They're interested in, like, in any big data sets, what they care about. And what you can see is dog attitudes toward dog breeds can just go up and down, just like that. And these are pretty fundamental things. When you bring an animal into your life, that's a big deal. And so we can see attitudes can change. I didn't used to believe that, but I do now.
Following up on that, you had several different other influences up there on your PowerPoint slide, and one of them was like cultural differences and categorization. So that's what I was thinking is, should we be working more in that area, namely getting humans to put ourselves in the same category with animals, for example. I didn't hear you talk much about like in groups and out groups, but a lot of the psychologists if you study identity, and because you talked about categories, and that's what your grandson was doing too.
Yes.
Like, he was categorizing certain animals as meat or not, because according to what he saw in the world, he was telling you what he saw in the world. So could we, can we work on, and Lori Marino and I talk a lot about this, calling ourselves animals more, and trying to get people to think of themselves as animals might be one way to break down some of these us and them categories.
It might. That's the good news. The bad news, I think, is that it might have the opposite effect. And I'm going to be interviewing Sheldon Solomon tomorrow, and his area is terror management. He's going to be talking about it. I just finished his book. And so what might happen is that calling us that we're animals, I don't want to give away his thing, but would have just the opposite effect. On the other hand, I think that humanizing animals is much more likely to succeed. And so, for example, if you look, there's no way in hell you're going to get everybody to stop eating meat, but you can get people to cut down. And similarly, it's harder to get people to care about the plight of chickens than it is to get them to care about something like great apes. It's easier, or dogs, let's say. And so one of the biggest successes, for example, of the animal rights movement has been the dramatic reduction in the number of animals, dogs and cats, killed in animal shelters each year. It's been incredible, from 25 million a year to maybe 3 or 4 or 5 million a year. Very, very successful. And that's because we more and more think of dogs as persons. Stephen Wise, he's not here yet. Stephen Wise, are you here yet? No, not yet. He'll be here tomorrow. But he's put a lot of his work into not working broadly for animal rights, but making a crack in that door by getting the legal status of chimpanzees changed. Not chimpanzees generally, but one chimpanzee at a time. And that becomes critical. For example, the outrage over the shooting of Cecil the lion that occurred a couple of years ago. It wasn't just any lion. It was a lion that we had humanized. We gave him a human name, a British name at that, rather than an African name. And I think humanizing animals is more likely to be successful than making animals humans think of themselves as animals. But I don't have any empirical data on that. That's just sort of...
Go the other way. I hear what you're saying, because I want to advocate that we become much more humble and start saying we're like them instead, because all social movements are always like you know, the oppressed group has to be like, but I'm like you, you know. And so, and then at some point they're like, I don't want to be so much like you. I don't want to assimilate. So then you get a diversity message. But I'd like us to be able to start saying, I'm not so great. I want to see myself in you instead of try to convince myself you're kind of like me. But I hear that it might be very difficult to do that because of the terror management theory that we're going to talk about.
I might have been
and the vulnerability.
Overly influenced by Sheldon's book. But right now I'm thinking that humanizing animals is a...
But I get your point that you could say we were individualizing them. We were making them a person, not necessarily a human. But like every time somebody knows of a certain animal, they care more about them. And like when I was studying for my master's thesis, I was studying news coverage of farmed animals. And when they talk about foot and mouth disease and all the millions of cows and sheep and other animals who were killed in Europe, if you remember that... there were all these mass graves and everything, and people were just kind of putting up with it in England. But there was a rumor that the actor pig who played in the Babe movie, that he was going to get killed. And then people were like, hey, wait a minute. So whenever we know, so then I was calling on the news to help us know more about the individuals, because that does change.
Well, this is another aspect. Yeah. This is sort of a heuristic. And the heuristic is, it's a moral heuristic, which is sort of sad, but it's true, which is that the greater the tragedy, the less people care. I mean, yesterday driving over here, I heard 40 people died in Baghdad in a car bomb. I just kept on driving. Because you hear that so much. And it's the same thing. The more, you know, people are more likely to care about
one animal than they are.
Yeah. And this is true with humans too. Yeah, it's like that kid, that little boy that died, you know, the little boy refugee died that died on the shores of the Mediterranean, and they had that picture.
Right.
That did more, vastly more than a shot of, 10,000 people in a refugee camp.
So that's something about human nature. Yeah, we can gravitate towards stories about individuals.
Absolutely.
One of the problems, though, about thinking of ourselves as animals, and we'll talk about the terror management theory, the vulnerability aspect of it, but also we talked a little bit today about religion. And so do you think the idea, you know, that we should be calling ourselves animals, that religion, the major world religions, are one of the biggest obstacles to that. That categorization really comes very strongly. It's cultivated out of religion. And that's the part I can't get past for people who do subscribe to a different religion. They may be very offended or definitely push back on this idea that humans aren't special.
I'm not an expert in that area, so I hate to weigh in on it. However, religion makes an enormous difference. And let me give an example. On the island of Sri Lanka, let me just finish this. The island of Sri Lanka, it's very, you have three major religions. You have maybe four, but you have Buddhist, you have Islam, you have Hindu. And whether or not you have a dog for a pet is almost totally determined by your religion. So 80% of Buddhist homes include a dog. Less than 4% of Muslim homes include a dog. And that's because dogs are considered unclean in the Quran. So religions have just an enormous, and there's so many religions that have, one of the things I've done is fascinating is I've read things like the Old Testament rules against which animals you can eat and which animals you can't eat. And they're absolutely fascinating, and they're just total arbitrariness, you know? And so religion has an enormous impact on our attitudes, but I'm really not an expert in that comparative religion.
Yeah.
All right, thank you for this great talk. I was just wanting to ask you, what do you think about plants and trees in terms of the taxonomy that we have decided that they are not animals? Obviously, they're, you know, organisms, they have much similarity to us. Sometimes they even get to live a lot more than us, and arguably they are more harmonious creatures than us, but we sort of don't grant them the idea that they're animals, like we don't grant animals the idea that they're sort of on our level. And I was wondering, what do you think of that, and also in terms of an interesting mind game for vegetarians?
Yeah, it's a fascinating mind game, and Michael Pollan had a piece in The New Yorker, I think it was in The New Yorker a couple years ago. So it turns out that plants have all kinds of things going on that most people don't acknowledge. They communicate with each other. They don't have a nervous system, but they make decisions about, they may even commit suicide sometimes so that other plants can live. These are things that we should not think about. These are things we should not think about. And so let's don't think about them. I was absolutely fascinated. The same thought came into my head. I thought, oh, so even the vegans are screwed now, man. They got nothing to eat. So, but this raises, so the answer is I think it's a terrific question. And I have thought about it. But my thought was that this is the nightmare scenario. And it raises the question of sentience as the as a good moral framework from which to look at animals. And my own view, nobody's arguing, I think, that plants are sentient, even though behave and stuff like that. But I've come to think that sentience is too low a bar. So for example, it's quite probable that bees are sentient creatures. Jonathan Balcom's new book on fish is amazing. You know, I've known Jonathan for many, many years, and I thought the story between the grouper and the eel is the same fish. But if you say that any animal with a nervous system that's capable of feeling pleasure and pain is sort of, it's just, we shouldn't be killing that animal, good luck driving your car down the road. And I have talked to animal activists, This is what I said, like, you can drive yourself crazy over moral consistency. I've talked to activists that said they felt guilty driving their car down the road. I've talked to animal activists that said that they felt guilty putting flea and tick powder on their dogs. And I think there's bigger, I took a guy to a rooster fight one time who was an organizer for Amnesty International. And at the end of the evening, I was unclear how he was going to react to this, you know, brutal event. At the end of the evening, we're driving home real late, and I said, all right, Tony, you know, what's your take on this? And this is a guy that spent his life trying to keep people from getting killed on the death penalty. He was a death penalty lawyer, and that's how he spent his life, trying to defend people from the death penalty. And he said, you know, for me, rooster fighting is a small moral problem. Now, I'm not saying chickens are a small moral problem. I think they're, as problems go, they're pretty big. But I think plants are a small moral problem. They're a big moral problem from an environmental point of view. We need those guys. But am I making sense? I mean, you know, I'm not getting upset about the rights of plants or bugs.
Let me just add, just from a vegan ethics standpoint, I think you're right that we could be accused of discriminating against plants as well. But I'm not usually a pragmatist, but I will say from a pragmatic standpoint that all animals, and we're animals, need to eat to survive, and that it's ethical to, you know, survive. And so, and plants are the more natural thing for us to eat. And so, and of course, when you eat animals, they survive on plants, so you're still eating plants. You know what I mean? So you're still killing plants either way. But that doesn't mean we shouldn't have respect for what capabilities we don't recognize in plants and trees. But from an environmental ethics standpoint, I like the idea of valuing trees and plants in a more holistic way, a more ecological way, and valuing animals in an individual way, which is an extension of human rights, right? The idea that individual animal lives matter, and then with plants and trees, it's kind of what they can do for all the animal lives. I would love to take kind of Schopenhauer or Schweitzer's idea that every single living thing on the planet, like, we have complete species equality for a tree and a mouse and a human, but then it gets so complicated you just cannot do that.
He
in reality.
He kept a gun around to shoot snakes.
Okay, so Schweitzer was not morally consistent either, as we're finding out. Okay.
Thanks for the presentation. I had a couple of trouble.
I can't see. Who am I
over here?
Oh, okay. Okay.
There is a couple of things in your presentation that troubled me. I'm a philosopher.
Oh, no, it's my nightmare.
Right. So here's a couple of things that troubled me. Your use of biologizing bias worried me. It wasn't so long ago that implicit bias in psychology was biologized. And there's been a lot of improvement on that discussion of implicit bias. I was just teaching some of my students in an ethics and science course about this. And it strikes me that your discussion about bias against animals that are perceived as threatening could do with a little bit of a dose of resituating that instead of biologizing it. And the second thing was about...
I'll go back to that. I don't understand what you're talking about.
Well, think you'd mentioned about queer ethics. You'd mentioned comments about gays and lesbians. You can do it with women and men. You can do it with the differently abled. There's a whole bunch of these biases that were biologized not that long ago. I can take you to readings in South Korean psychiatry where they still biologize these biases. And so all I'm saying is that when you talk about, you know, an innate, whatever that would mean, fear of snakes,
it's a good example.
All my alarm bells go off because this sounds really familiar.
Well, your alarm bells could go off, but I was careful to say that I think that there's empirical evidence, and I can cite you the studies showing that right now we have a predisposition to make, and this has been shown, demonstrated by a series of studies with us and on monkeys, is that there is a predisposition toward easy learning for some things and not others. Humans are not born a blank slate. If you're calling that biologizing, I'm guilty. I'm totally guilty of saying we're not a blank slate.
I wouldn't disagree with that. I think that's right. I'm not a strict associationist or anything, but I do think... in much the same way that implicit bias has become more nuanced, because also they're not denying in-group, out-group dynamics, and they're not denying its importance. What they're denying is that you can biologize it.
Well, this is a hugely important question, and snakes are a particularly good example. I'm not afraid of snakes. I'm deeply attracted to them. I developed the first personality test for snakes, and before. Which involved, by the way, having snakes bite my hand in a certain fashion. I've been bitten by snakes more than anyone in human history, probably tens of thousands of times in this personality test. So we have these differences. And what the other thing that I'm taking out of this is that our attitudes can change. Like if you look at cultural differences in attitudes towards snakes, there's snakes that worship. This came up before. There's snakes that worship them. There's people that like snakes, and if I'm biologizing them, I'm not going to apologize for that. And in terms of I'm not quite sure. I think the
worry I would have was I heard intimations of innateness in what you were talking about, and so that would be a way of biologizing something if it's unlearned.
Yeah, I didn't say it was unlearned. I'm saying there's learning is a.
Well, that's what I was. That was hearing. But just the second thing about inconsistency as well. Just before going on.
Do think that's part of human nature.
Well, here's my worry about that is I think you're misunderstanding what goes on in philosophy when they appeal to consistency. It's not right. It's not that we deny that people are inconsistent. It's an aspiration.
Yeah.
And to abandon that and embrace moral inconsistency.
Yeah.
Given that we draw moral lines differently, you're abandoning moral objectivity.
Yes. I'm probably guilty of that. And what I did when I was writing that last chapter of my book. I realize you're right, and what I found is that I was in a position where I had no sense of morals in terms of where to go. In other words, if I'm saying you know we can't be consistent, I knew that we can't trust our heart. Our heart told us that slavery was okay. Or you mentioned homosexuality. Our heart told us for years and years and years that demonized homosexuality. And so I don't trust our guts. So I can't trust our guts for moral decision making. I can't trust logic for moral decision making, because then I wind up where the place where Joan Dunier was, where You know, you save a, you know, the spider has as much right to life as a human. And I had no place to go, at which point I got a book contract, I got to end the damn thing, and with a reason to live, and that's when I ran into Michael Mountain, who, thank God. But I appreciate your point, and I think you're getting really to the heart of the matter. And let me just say, there's a bigger issue here, and I want to make this, and I think you're dead on right. And the subtext of your comment is that what I talked about was not really about animals. It has to deal with moral decision-making in general, how we apply to human beings, and I think you're exactly right. So the more I think about it, I have to acknowledge once again the philosophers are smarter than I am, and which is why I avoid you guys. But you're making a really good point. My guess is we agree on some very...
Hi, I'm Eva Chinoda. I'm from Zimbabwe, here. I was the lawyer who dealt with Cecil the Lion case. Yes. I have a question. According to your presentation, I would like to agree with what you say that not everyone is into pet finding. What you talked about Kenya is exactly how we treat and view dogs in Zimbabwe. We don't keep them in the house. We keep them in the yard. We love them. They're a source of security. We don't have, or we can't afford, to give them the standards that are given here because we can't afford.
Yes.
My worry is about having a slice of bread first before I can take my dog to the vet. When I leave extra food, I feed my dog. Yeah. That's how we treat them. That's how we love them. But after going through the presentation and being exposed to a different culture, to a different world, I'm thinking, what's the best strategy? Do we improve the manner in which we keep our dogs, or we advocate for culture change so that we are also able to keep them according to the standards or animal welfare standards here, or according to the way pets are kept here? Thank you.
First of all, I'm just stunned to meet somebody who's involved in the Cecil case. Thanks for your comments. If I could do one experiment, I feel this. I'm going to biologize again here, and I'm very interested in why humans. You know, we talked this morning about, you know, things that separate humans from other animals, and I think one of the things that separates humans from other animals is pet keeping. We don't see human-like pet keeping in any other species that I have seen evidence of. Although these other species do have the biological desire for nurturance, and they do form bonds with members of other species in situations involving humans. And that's those things you see on YouTube videos and all that stuff about, you know, lions falling in love with lambs and stuff like that. There's tons of that stuff available, but you don't see it in the wild. And I talked to a guy that was a game warden in Tanzania one time, and his wife had brought in a German shepherd into this village that they were living in. It was their pet dog. And what happened is that the kids in the village, who never treated dogs as pets, saw them treating their dog as a pet and started playing with the dog and started treating the dog as a pet, and there was this social change. And one of the things I'm interested in is the rapidity of cultural change. And I would love to do an experiment where I, you know, would go to places in Africa where they don't treat dogs like that, and then I think you could change those attitudes in an incredibly short period of time. Because I think, although pet keeping is not a human universal, I think that humans easily fall in love with pets. And I would just love to do an experiment where we actually tried to change those attitudes. And I know I didn't really answer your question, but I don't have a good answer for it. But I really think, you know, to me, it's fascinating, these cultural differences in pet keeping. So for example, in Amazonia, keeping of pets is very common, wild pets like, you know, parrots and monkeys and stuff like that. In New Guinea, it's not. So why should you have pet keeping in one culture and not another culture? And I think it boils down to cultural differences and the very rapidity of cultural learning. So that was not a good answer to your question, but it's the best I can do right now. Yes.
Okay. met a Chinese girl who was studying in Japan. We were walking with our son, and she said, one of the first things she said to me was, she said, oh, hello, do you have a doggy? I miss my doggy so. And she and her family lived in a coastal city in China, and her parents were looking after her dog. And it has to do with the rise of a middle class pretty much in China, in Asia,
yes.
Where we have the stereotype that there are some hard attitudes towards animals.
Yes.
So I think it's partly economic, but I think that modeling is, as you said, is probably also important. And maybe, I don't know, this would be an issue for controlling pet populations humanely, sterilization. Fewer dogs to take care of, you can give them a better life in the same sense that some of us argue that a smaller human population would have a number of beneficial things, environmental and less suffering among humans.
Yeah,
people could care for them.
I'm really glad you mentioned that. And in a lot of cultures, to own a pet was a signal of wealth. Only wealthy people had pets. We had an interesting thing. Again, I say dog breed popularity. And this happened in the United States right after World War II. And what happened was that very few people had purebred dogs up until World War II. And for some reason, the American Kennel Club, there was an explosion of interest in purebred dogs. I think because they were a signal of wealth. So people would get mutts and stuff like that, but all of a sudden they wanted pedigree dogs. And so this was the rise of the popularity of purebred dogs in the United States, and it had to do with social class and wealth. China's a particularly interesting example because during the Cultural Revolution, Mao banned pets as being a bourgeois affectation, and they got rid of the dogs. Well, now as China becomes more middle class, pets are becoming more and more popular, particularly dogs. And what you see is the same sort of thing here. So, for example, there was a fad for Tibetan Mastiff. Yeah, there was a fad for Tibetan Mastiffs, and we sort of spread very rapidly and then died very quickly. And they were costing tens of thousands of dollars, and now they were just basically killing them. There's too many of them. So I think you're exactly right. I think money, social class, and pet keeping are intimately tied together.
You really hit a nerve for me about if you can't handle moral inconsistency, your life is going to suck.
I shouldn't have said that.
No, it's wonderful. It's wonderful.
It's my mouth talking,
And then I also hear a lot of us bring up individuality, because I think about so many people who created social change historically, Gandhi, so forth, their life sucked. Many times.
Oh, so you're agreeing with me.
So
that's okay.
Sort of,
yes.
Yeah, there's a continuum.
Yes.
Within our population of how much we're willing for life to suck.
I think there's a problem to moral clarity, and this is one of these things that I'm very ambivalent about. On the one hand, we need guys like Jesus. We need Gandhi, but there's a cost that comes to that. There can be a personal cost that comes with that. When I was interviewing animal activists, some of the interviews were incredibly great. People had wonderful lives. They had something to live for. They were bright and cheery when they woke up in the morning. Other people were basically unhappy. Their marriage was breaking up I talked to people whose marriages were breaking up because of conflict over animals. I remember one woman, young woman, who told me, I quit trying to date men because, just as she put it, she said, just going out for dinner becomes an ordeal. I met a woman who told me, the circus comes to town, I'm out there with a poster, and what I sometimes feel like I should do is just take my kids to the damn circus. And then she said, sometimes I feel I just don't want to be Jesus anymore. I just want to be a normal human being. And then I met other people that said that they found that they had to take a moral break every now and then, that they would, get in a plane and go down to Jamaica or something and not think about these issues. So I think there's a moral cost. There can be a moral cost. People who, well, we've got a, if you're a vegan, your friends are, my guess is your friends are less likely to invite you out for dinner because they don't know how to cook for you, you know? And so
is that why no one ever invites me to a dinner party?
Yes.
I see dinner parties on television, nice person. And I'm like, who's going to these dinner parties?
You're a nice person. You are a nice person.
Yes, they don't know what.
So that's what I'm. And I'm not saying you shouldn't do that. I'm not saying we need people to do that. But I'm just saying that it comes at a cost. And here the thing is, you're only around here once. You know, if you can make an adjustments for living with that, if you're paralyzed by that, you don't want to get. I remember a guy telling me he felt guilty every time he got in his car because he found out that tires contained animal products. It's like, damn, man, you got other things to think about than that. You know? I'm sorry.
Hi. On moral ambiguity and being inconsistent, you know, Gandhi treated his wife miserably.
No.
Yes. Martin Luther King was a sex addict. Okay?
That's...
Cesar Chavez was the most vicious political infighter you've ever seen, okay? I mean, I've studied the lives of these men. This is all very true, okay? Jesus, I don't know about. But the point is that we do the best we can.
Yeah.
And the other point I wanted to make
By the way, I totally agree with that, and that's basically my argument. It doesn't give moral clarity, but
You do the best you can.
But the
gut versus the brain, when I was younger, I was a sexist, and I'm not anymore.
Right.
And I'm not a sexist from my gut, because my brain taught myself.
Yes.
When I was younger,
yes.
I was fairly homophobic.
Yes.
I'm not anymore.
Right.
It's not my head, it's my gut, all right? I was a meat eater for probably 55 years, all right? I'm not anymore. It's my head to my gut.
That's right.
And that's really, I think, the process is it happens when you are, when you school yourself. You're your own therapist. You have to be your own moral leader, seems to me.
If someone were to say, like, you know, what would you recommend that I read? I would recommend one book, and it would be Jonathan Haidt's book, The Righteous Mind. It doesn't deal much with animals. It deals with why people don't understand each other from different political views. And he makes the same argument you do. The writer has the ability to control the elephant. The question is how it does it. I completely agree with everything you just said. We're not hopeless. We can change. And what Haidt says, one of the best ways to do it is not do it alone. You said you took command of yourself. But he argues that one way to do it is through your friends and stuff like that. So people that you talk to, your support system, that change feels fine. For example, what I discovered, I don't know if this would be possible. I think people like hunters and circus animal trainers and animal activists have something important in common. And that is they all really deeply love animals. And I know some of you guys aren't going to believe that, but I've talked to these people. I've had tough circus animal trainers doing interviews with them happen a bunch, break down and cry when they told me about an animal that had come to an end or had died or something like that. So these people, in their own way, love animals. So there's a sense of commonality there. And the question is, there's a lot of these arguments, by the way, are related to map onto abortion. And my guess is that people that are opposed to abortion and people that support abortion have something in common, and that is they want fewer kids in this world. There's a common unwanted kids in this world. If you can get people to say, well, all right, there's some commonalities that we have here, that may help change people's minds.
Hal, I want to jump in here because I don't agree with you that hunters, circus trainers, and animal activists all deeply love animals.
I know you don't.
I definitely don't. And the reason I don't is because we have to define the term like. Liking can mean many things to people. It could mean I like to be amused by this animal. I like to eat this animal. I like to ride on this animal. I like to go out with my son and kill this animal. And so we really have to ask ourselves, what do we mean by liking animals? I mean, people that like animals go to zoos, and it's, at some level, they like animals, right?
Yeah.
But I don't think that we can necessarily equate the likes across different categories, because deeply loving and respecting something is very different than being amused by something or caring about. Hunters care about deer. They care about them because they want to kill them. That's different.
Yeah, I disagree. I'm not a hunter, and I don't understand hunters really, but I do understand cockfighters. I do understand them, and my feeling about them was that they did have a deep respect and love for these animals, and they actually liked some of them in the sense that you might like your dog, you might like your dog, your cat, and I know the circus animal trainers that I talked to had very, very deep relationships with their animals. And I know, you know, you and I are going to disagree about this. That's okay. I still like you.
But how, like, would those cockfighters put their kids, who they also love, in a ring to fight to the death?
Would they what?
Would they put their kids in a ring to fight to the death? I mean, like, I wouldn't want that guy, the cockfighter, babysitting my dog or something. You know what I mean? Because his version he's not protecting them. It's kind of like the animal husbandry arguments in factory farming. Yeah. They say they care for the animals to keep them alive, but not really. I think they don't respect them enough.
Yeah,
to
they do.
Liberate
that's,
them.
But see, that's the thing that I find so intriguing, that's the thing that I find so intriguing, how they can do this. I never quite got in my head. Let me mention the thing about the circus animal trainers. I did a study of circus animal trainers. I interviewed, over a period of years, I interviewed about probably 15 or 20 of them. And I never wrote anything about it. When I was writing my book, I was getting tremendous pressure from my publisher and my literary agent to write a chapter about circus animal trainers, and I didn't do it. And the reason is that I didn't feel that I really understood them. Even after doing these interviews, I felt like, you know, these relationships are so, they are so deep, they are so much about ultimately life and death, that I couldn't do them. I felt like I could write about cockfighters, I felt like I could write about animal activists and do veterinary school students, scientists. I felt like I could do them justice. With the circus animal trainers, it's like, damn, man, I do not understand you guys. How you can put these animals in these little things and go around, and yet you do really love them. So I know I'm the outlier here. I know everybody's going to agree with Lori, not me.
Two really short ones. Right. And one is over there, and then Gally.
Okay, promise mine is short. Just following up real quick on the, you just mentioned abortion. I just finished a really great book called Beating Hearts, Colben Dorff, that compares the animal rights to the abortion rights. So that's
what does it? What does it conclude?
It's similar to what we were mentioning with I guess Wise is going to do in terms of drawing the line.
Yeah.
So his on both of those, the notion is that whichever can feel pain.
Yeah.
There's a line.
Reason why I'm so interested in that is when I was doing my study of animal activists. At the end of the interview, I started asking people how they felt about abortion. And most of the animal activists that I interviewed were women. Most of them were liberal women, and almost all of them were pro-choice when it came to abortion. But the interesting thing is that question really hit a nerve, because they would get pissed off at me for asking the question in many cases. Why did you ask that question? Oh, I wish you hadn't have asked me that. I wish you had. Or contrary, I don't see any relationship between the two. And I think that's something that's sort of a...
It's a very natural parallel.
I think there's a natural parallel. And I'm, by the way, I'm very pro-choice. Although there's parts of that debate that where I'm inconsistent. For example, I used to berate my students for being inconsistent on abortion, but I realize that so am I, because I'm uncomfortable with abortion to pick the sex of a child. Even on the one hand, I feel like a woman should have the right to have an abortion for any reason she wants. On the other hand, that makes me really queasy.
Right.
And I can't.
And the authors actually dig into that.
Yeah. That's my logic.
The main question I had, because I've seen the statistic that you've had for several years is basically about recidivism and the, kind of the failure of veganism and the, you know, that line that goes across. And I'm so that statistic is basically driven from surveys and people admitting or, you know, admitting their own failures. I'm curious about approaching from the other side, that if we're seeing Tyson, you know, buy, is it Gardein or whatever, the vegan foods, that we're seeing more and more capitalist interest, more and more companies, they're selling, something's going on.
Something is totally going on. You are so right. In my little town, you can buy vegan stuff now. You know, there's
vegan
two
diners in the back, which you couldn't get before.
There is definitely something in the air. Something is going on.
It doesn't
show up in the meat statistics, but you're absolutely right. There's totally something going on.
Okay, so it's not every day we get to meet a psychologist who studied animal activists. And so I'm really interested in the way you've compared animal activists to circus trainers and that sort of thing. But I'm really wondering, do you have like a view of a profile of an animal activist, a general profile? And one thing that I'm particularly interested in is the role of guilt. Just anecdotally, in the people that I've met, that usually there's been some incident in childhood that preys on them. So what makes an animal lover go into animal activism as opposed to not going into it?
Well, I think I don't have an easy answer for that one. I can give you, I've written a paper on that, and the paper's available online, and you can read it, so it's getting old now, but the paper's called The Movement Is My Life. It's talking about Movement Is My Life, the Psychology of Animal Activism, and I'd take a look at it, and I'd be curious about your impressions of it. My general sense was of activists, first of all, most of them were women. They were mixed in terms of why they got into the movement. Some of them got into the movement very quickly. Somebody gave them a copy of Peter Singer's book, bingo, their life changed. Other people got into it very slowly. They originally got in for health reasons. They gave something out. And, one of the most interesting things was, I was interested in, I didn't like to use the word, to the degree to which animal activism sort of separates you from other people, and I didn't ask the question like that. And I hate to use this word, but is there a sense of moral, there's a sense of moral clarity that comes with activism that I think makes you different from other people. And we actually did a study of this where we studied the moral philosophies of animal activists, wasn't moral philosophies, but it was the source of moral attitudes. And what we found was that activists were much more likely to have a sense of moral clarity. This is called absolutists. They tend to be more absolutists in their policy, in their views. Sheldon, in his book, which he's going to talk about tomorrow, he ends his book with talking about people that are between a rock and a hard place, and people that are the rocks. He says have this sense of moral clarity and an easy sense of right and wrong. And I think many of the activists had that sense. By the way, I'm not like that. I see the world, I'm in the hard place. I don't see an easy place for moral guidance. I think that's one thing that separates me from animal activists.
You mentioned the disgust factor, remember that?
Let me mention one other thing. You mentioned the thing about when I was doing this work, Ken Shapiro, who's also a psychologist and an animal activist, he asked me, and Andrew Rowan has said the same thing, they thought that most animal activists had some sort of sexual trauma early in their life, that they had been abused. And I did not ask that. And there was another person, a psychologist, that was also studying that, and she said she found the same thing. I felt like I could not just walk into somebody's house and as a guy, as a male, and expect them to spill the beans about the stuff that you're talking about. So I did not deal with that in my study. But if you're interested in that study, if you send me an email, I'll be happy to send you the study, and you can let me know what you think.
Well, with that, I want to thank Hal and
let's take a poll right now.
And Carrie again. Thank you, Hal, for this fountain of data.